Hey, this is sorry my hair and everything, but anyway, I've been super busy. I've been getting all my classes together and then trying to start running again. Really like to have a good climbing season after 15 years of not rock climbing really. Would like to lose, 30 pounds. So but the last, period of my life is 20 years has been pretty intense. But learning to find the peaceful edges and dots in the, photo of our life or video. I'm helping a friend right now do night work with her mom. Oh my, hold on, my video is gonna fall over. There, with her mom, doing home health care at night. So it's been kind of a little bit exhausting, but seem to be getting better with it. And I just woke up and just having coffee, so. Apologize for how scary I look, but yeah, I'm not gonna get all dressed up to do these videos. This is real life stuff. So I was watching the Catholic channel this morning because the older lady who I'm caretaking is like super devout, and it's interesting, but listening to it like within 20 hour or 20 minutes, like even in the background, it had like sucked the life out of me and kind of made me feel like a lack of joy. And just even though they say it in like nice, peaceful words, it's horrifying. Like the punishment and hate for yourself and all these things that you've done wrong. It's just overwhelms me. I mean, yeah, no wonder, so many people are living in like unbelievable amounts of fear. So, and we live in such a joyless society, like America, like you never see anyone happy. No one ever looks another person in the eye. There's no like smiling. It just is horrid. So anyway, this video. What are you talking? I don't want to. No. Okay, up here. Come on, up, Jin. She's trying to like eat the bad guy outside, which is good. We love her for that. She can get the bad guy. Are you getting a bad guy? Well, she doesn't want to be on video, so she's. Are you coming up? Come on, up. Let's go. Come on. Come on. Right here. Jin. No, she's gonna go into her house. So, anyway, what I did want to talk to you about is sometimes I remember things or I have discussions with other people. I've had so many things that have happened to me. Experience wise in my life, and sometimes it's hard to remember or stop long enough to communicate it. But when I was a little girl, the first ETs, beings that abducted me, they abducted me for up until I was like 23. And then there was a shift, and about 23, I think, then I had some government fake UFO abductions. And after 23, the grays started abducting me. And so I've just had lots of different experiences. And sometimes the I wasn't abducted. You know, sometimes I had fourth kind. I mean, I guess it's all fourth kind. But I would have experiences where they would be standing outside my window, or last summer, the first bird ET that I've seen was wearing really nice coat and hat, trying to hide itself in the foliage in the woods, and was watching me, and I woke up and saw it. And I think I've talked about that experience in other videos. And sometimes I'm not sure what they're wanting. Sometimes I think there's information planted for triggers that will come later. And so I've seen a lot of different kind of, you know, I just call them ETs. It's just easier. You know, I would be an extraterrestrial to them. So, you know, in all political correctness. But I just want to kind of talk about the experience from the first ETs that were the good ETs. And people ask me all the time what they look like, and I still don't really have like a recollection of what they look like. But I think I've always been accustomed to being okay seeing beings and shadow people or extraterrestrials, and it doesn't raise a lot of fear in me. So I have to suspect that the first ones that abducted me probably were pretty scary. They taught me different things. I think that the last visitation I had with them was when I was 23, and I remember it. And kind of weird talking about this because I kind of feel like I really miss them, which is strange. Usually I'm fighting them, right? Hey, take that. You're trespassing. Leave me alone. I need some space. So during the course of growing up, they taught me different things. And, you know, I have connections with bees and wasps ever since I was little, even though I got attacked by a hive this last summer and got really sick. I really think that they were actually trying to help me because they could have killed me. They could have easily killed me, no problem. But I think, you know, these extraterrestrials, I'm going to call it buggy, they may have been bug races, because they were very peaceful, non-dominant, caring, compassionate. Like, I can remember my hand always being held in a loving way and them pointing things out and teaching me. And maybe that's where my love of nature comes from. And ever since I've been a little girl, I've always had these really crazy scenarios with bugs on this planet. I mean, crazy stuff will start happening. And even people that are around in my vicinity, they'll totally notice bees, earwigs. One time when I was like 3 years old, I was standing on a red ant pile, and all the red ants had crawled all over me. And my dad said that he ran with me and threw me up on a tailgate and started, you know, taking my clothes off and spraying me down with a hose, and he said there was not one bite. So I think my early ET contacts had a lot to do with the bug world. So also just a thing. So the native people, the men, when they do the fancy dancing, you know, when they have that little doodad flicking on the top of their head, that's for the grass beings, the grass people, which is also in respect and honor to the plants and also the insects. So when they're doing that dance, they're doing it. That's why they do it so passionately, because they're doing it to activate magnetic energy and prayers, intention in a good way for those beings on this planet. And they would call them people, like the trees are the standing people, right? So they really consider them of equal value to themselves and or more important. Anyway, so because it's beautiful once you know that, right? Once you see that dancer out there and what he's dancing for. Probably some of the most important work on our planet is from the Native people. I think it's what's held this whole darn thing together. The ones that still held on to a lot of their ancient knowledge and utilized it. And now they're coming back and they're remembering and they're getting their technologies, their dance, their sounds, their drums, their songs back together to pull this planet back together. Okay, so I also have had 6 major head injuries in my life. Major concussions. The 2 happened to me, 13 and older, were accidents. One was a motorcycle accident and one was a really serious car accident. And then I had 4 when I was young, one being birth trauma. Because I was so big, my mom was in labor for like 24 hours. And they had to use forceps. And they broke my collarbone on the right side to get my arm to hang down to be able to pull me out. So my mom thought I would have brain damage for my life, because of the force and trauma. And I think that's a lot of why I do traditional osteopath medicine and work on small babies, because I have healed this trauma in myself, and it makes it easier for me to heal that trauma in them so that they don't have to fight with their health, you know, their entire lives. So before age 23, every time I would have a head injury, these first extraterrestrials that abducted me would fix them, including when I was around 6 or 7 years old. There was a little boy who would come and visit his grandparents across the fence. And my dad would warn me, you know, don't talk to that little boy. He's violent, he's aggressive, don't egg him on in any way, shape, or form, you know, don't just stay the hell away from him. And one day he was just calling me names, so I started calling him names back. I was done. And he threw what thought was like a rifle squirt gun, but it was actually a full army rifle. And it came flying over the fence, you know, spiraling. And then the butt of it hit me. Like a crack that runs. I can still feel the crack. The crack goes from like up here down into here. So you can see it if I rub it. So it cracked. Tore the skin off, cracked open my whole skull, and my brain was hanging a little outside of the skull. And I was completely unconscious. And needless to say, my parents thought I was dead and that I would die and I wouldn't survive. But the ETs fixed it and continue to live. Also had major respiratory stuff. You know, my early childhood was terrible because I was a star kid, a highly evolved being that was placed in this nightmare, trying to tread this nightmare, you know, school and family life and alcohol abuse a little bit in my family on the side that I was with most of the time, even though they were really loving, wonderful people. So there was just a lot of things going on, and then I was born to the genetics of my mom's bloodline, which goes way back. And our shaman, non-indigenous shaman, women, it's all women. Men are mostly born into our family. But we're all very psychic, very intuitive, very knowing. They're all dead now. And so there was like shamans, prophets, you know, blah, blah, blah. Kind of each time a new baby would be born, a different ability would be kind of passed on, like maybe three of them. There was this ability to work with the earth and generate plants. My mom used to grow zucchini plants that were taller than people in sand. And she also had kind of a gift with animals. So the natural world. Her mother was was born from a shaman woman and spent that time and then had to find safety in this world so that we weren't like Satanists or, you know, people don't talk about our bloodline, but the bloodlines, the good bloodlines, have always been sent here to make this place better. And, so that my grandmother above my mom, she was, I always talk about her, she was an exorcist and a prophet of the Pentecostal church. She didn't need the church for her abilities. She hid in the church to utilize her abilities. And then her mother was like a shaman, herbal medicine woman who had abilities to heal. It's interesting because I've ended up with all three of the big traits of gifts of that line. And then with my dad's side that I wasn't really around as much as I wanted to be is the Russian shaman line. So maybe one day I'll go to Russia and learn more about me. So I used to get really sick too. Not only was I getting a lot of these head injuries, I was having really, you know, even for my family, they were intense paranormal kind of, you know, experience and healers and shamans and even for them, it was pretty tough, because, you know, I think that my mom spent a lot of time trying to keep me energetically under control, because it was, say, for example, you're driving an aircraft, but you don't really know how to drive that aircraft, but yet you have all these tools to drive that aircraft, and you accidentally hit those things, and things happen. So I also went through a period during that time where these good extraterrestrials were really taking care of me, and healing me, healing my injuries, and I grew up kind of resenting, let's just say, people who were mediums and psychics, that they would get around me. And the first words that would come out of their mouth, even as an adult, were, wow, you're special. You're protected. You know, and I just wanted to have like a normal life. But you know what? It's never going to happen. It's not gonna happen. So I ended up getting a really bad fever, and maybe twice, and was really three times, and I was really sick through between age 4 and 5. And after I got well, I almost died. I had serious pneumonia 3 times, and even the hospital told my parents to take me home because they didn't really have anything else to help me with. And during that whole year, I used to travel the atom highway, you know, what I know today as being kind of atoms and molecules. But when I would get really sick when I was little, I would focus on something until like I had hawk vision and it went into like an atom or a molecule. And then I would leave and I would travel the atom highway or the molecule highway for whatever time frame, even with the head injury, you know. So after these, you know, three different events, I would have these burns, a type of stigmata burn where, you know, it smells like roses, but I would have, you know, like two different symbols, the same ones all the time on the same foot. But I would have different symbols like branded from the inside of my body from these high fevers onto my feet. And and then the ETs would, I think the fires were the fevers, which I call the fires. They opened up energy for whatever energy needed to come through my body and into each other to cross, thus grounding and bringing two energies into one through me onto the planet. And so a lot of the weirdest probably period of my life was governed by these good ETs. So I'm just going to tell them real quick I missed them. So okay, so I just want to tell you about the last experience that I had. They used to take me and they had this craft, and it had kind of a, you know, dip-shaped bottom, and I think that they opened doors, something like that, or it was a TV screen of what was below, like the, it could pick it up and then transfer it as an image. But I remember I'd lay on it and I would look down and they would fly me over different planets. And so when I was 23, I was living in this little cabana kind of thing in Washington State. I had just had some work done by a Lakota Sioux medicine woman, powerful woman, who ended up shortly after that. Well, actually, I think I was apprenticing with her at that time. I was getting ready to, but I had the session with her. Anyway, they took me and went on this journey, and we went and really checked Mars out. I didn't know that it was going to be my last visitation. So, by them. And, there were parts of Mars that were incredible. Like, the red planet on parts of it doesn't even describe the gorgeous beauty, really, of the red color and the sand and the natural land structures. And it just was gorgeous. So when they put me back, I was sitting up in bed and there was this window that was kind of up, and I was sitting in bed. And then I noticed I was sitting in bed, and then I noticed the window was huge, like it had no ends to it. And then I watched it close back into the small window on my wall, and then the rest, like it was color, you know, as it rainbow kind of color, blues, as it was shifting and these rays were coming out, and then boom, and then it was the window. And that was it. And I've never seen them, you know, again in this experience, but they have profoundly impacted me far more and beyond anything or anyone has impacted me in this experience. So I try to talk about a lot of these things so people who have star kids or star kids who are older, who are looking for experiences to identify. You know, when I was growing up, I like wrote the Catholic Church. All these different kinds of things. I read the Seth Roberts books. I read all the Carlo Castaneda books. I read tons of astrology books. I read, you know, searching for who, and even to this day, like I constantly contact UFO people. And then they have me take these online tests or whatever else. It's like super ridiculous. Like, I think because like my stories are so far out there that even the far out there people can't begin to wrap their heads around the truth, even though they think they're involved in the truth. And they're not. And I would be very concerned about these star children groups who are documenting your children or have documented you and what your capabilities and abilities are. I think they're sinister and they don't know that they're sinister. And I would be terribly afraid to allow them to have that kind of information and document it for my children and myself. You know, like I've had several kidnap attempts. One I know for sure was from NASA because I was directly contacted by NASA when I was 18, and they murdered the psychiatrist or psychologist that I was going to and burned down the building after I refused to meet with NASA through him. He was approached and he was asked to do their dirty work. A psychiatrist that I showed a lot of my abilities to back in the day. So I'm like 48 now. This would have happened when I was 19. Thank God I have a really high intuitive level to know how to navigate things like that. Like, you know, it's just a natural thing. Okay. So this is Bridget Lynn Dolgoff, Conscious of Economics and the Urban Farm Project. And I just wanted to talk to you about my early childhood ET experiences and how they related to my experience with insects on this planet and my head injuries and chronic respiratory problems. And how they did surgery on me and helped me and literally kept me alive and then left me at age 23. Anyway, that's all I have to report today. It's Sunday. Take the day off. Find something beautiful to stare at. That's what I'm going to do. I'm going to be working on my flyers. I'm going to be doing two ceremonies. One is going to be called Earth Medicine Prayer Circle, and I'm going to put out a blanket, and people are going to sit around it, and we're going to talk about making prayer smoke medicine, and just some other ideas on how to use native shamanism type prayer work. And then the second one is going to be three parts. It's going to have a two-hour class on protocol and how to manage these practices that will happen, where you'll be able to experience and use the practices on the second part, which will be the ceremony. So the first one's about the teachings and preparation for fire ceremony. The second one will be the fire ceremony. And that will go anywhere from 5 to 8 hours. And we're going to take it through the period of darkness. So we're going to start really late at night and then take it through 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning through our period of darkness. So if there's things that we need to face, we can face them then. And then the third part is going to be when we come together and we can communicate our experiences. And I'm also going to give continued practices that people can utilize as individual as I can. And then people, if they want to book an appointment after, and then we can sit down and do a personal dialogue about that, we can do that as well. So there'll be three parts in the second ceremony. And I call it the fire medical ceremony. And through a lot of my native teachers doing firework, this is kind of my work. And since I work a lot with health and stuff, it just seems natural that my firework would be around getting well, mental, emotional, physical, or spiritual, you know, healing and wellness and those kinds of things. So hopefully I'll get those flyers done today, and I will get them out on the internet, and I will try to post a link with this video as well. So if you're interested in coming to Reno and participating in those ceremonies, you are welcome to do so. Okay. Also, don't forget I've got, my booty is stiff. Don't forget I've got 4 awesome classes that are going to be starting. You can find them on the website, on the events calendar, or the blog. Oops, sorry. Anyway, that's it. It's time to shower, and I'll talk to you later. Bye.